Alright, today I will talk about the gestational trophoblastic disease and gestational trophoblastic neoplasia. In gestational trophoblastic disease, is a spectrum of pregnancy-related disorder ranging from benign hereditary formal to malignant conditions. In other ways, it's a tumor that related origin from the placenta cause. Okay, there is a benign condition and malignant conditions. So in the incident is about in the gestational trophoblastic disease overall incident is about 1 to 2 over 1000 delivery. So the risk factor associated with the gestational trophoblastic disease is a maternal age, especially in the advanced maternal age. Okay, age more than 14 years old is a have 5 to 10 folds risk of GTD. At the same time, young age also high risk for GTD. In view of, because the ovum is a high risk of abnormal fertilization happen with the old ovums, right? At the same time, had history of miscarriage, history of spontaneous miscarriage, just mild, about 2 folds. But if patient had history of gestational trophoblastic disease previously, some books says it's about 10 fold risk. Others says it's if first time smaller pregnancy is about 1.8%. And have 2 molar pregnancies, about 18%. And then if more than 4 molar pregnancies, about 81% risk of recurrent of molar pregnancy. Right. And then some is a low creatine intakes or vitamin A deficiency also can cause. It's one of the risk factor. And then okay. Smoking also is one of the risk factor because it's a abnormal fertilization happen, abnormal ovum, abnormal sperms, right? In the blood grouping, actually, not sure, paternal age is also some say study is a low associated risk. Okay, and then okay, autos is another is like autos. Some study say it's autosomal recessive, but okay. About the gestational trophoblastic disease, we start with the molar pregnancy. We have 2 types of molar pregnancy: it's a complete molar pregnancy or partial mon. In the partial mon, it's a triploid karyotyping, means it's one maternal haploid, one maternal ovum, fertilized with two paternal haploid. Okay, so total is a 69 XXY or XXX or XXY, right? And then that's why it's a become partial hereditary formal. In the complete mon, is a totally is a dispermic, mean no ovum, is a empty. The sperm is fertilized inside the empty ovum, and it duplicate inside the empty ovum, right? Okay. So in the clinical characteristics of the complete and partial mon, the difference is more significant clinical feature in the complete mon. For example, like hyperemesis gravidarums, and then uterus larger than dates, okay, anemic, and then PV pervaginal bleeding. Some is by ultrasound finding we can feature as a thecal cyst. If developed, means because of prolong of LH or beta ECG exposure. The size is between 3 to 20 cm. It regress after beta ECG falling down. If present of bilateral thecal cyst, risk of GTN is high. Okay. About the preeclampsia and hypertension, hyperthyroidism may present with a complete mole. Okay. How we diagnose molar pregnancy? So first is a beta ECG. Beta ECG, the amount of beta ECG is a reflect of the size of, it's related with the size of the molar pregnancy itself by the ultrasound findings, because it reflect the proliferation of molar pregnancy, because HCG was increased by CCC to topoblast. Based on the ultrasound picture, the complete mass we can see is a complex of echogenic intrauterine mass containing the small multicystic. There is no fetal tissue or no amniotic sac since, compared to the partial mold, there is a presence of fetal tissue and some is present of amniotic sacs. Okay. And then at the same time, the complete mass is like a snowstorm appearance, and then it's larger, it's a large, more than gestational age. Okay. So based on the HPE result, we can see in the microscopically different between complete and partial. In the complete mold, there is absence of fetus, but the partial mold present of fetus part. Okay. And then about the villus, is a diffuse villus in the complete mold, but in the partial is a focal villus edema. Alright, topoblastic proliferation is a markedly present in the complete, but in the partial mold is a focal or minimal. Right, histochemistry, the P57 or KIP2 is a negative in complete mold and then present in the positive in the partial mold. Okay, right. Okay. In terms of management, so the first, okay, about the in terms of management, is we manage by suction and curettage. Okay, if suction and curettage, which is the first line management of molar pregnancy. Okay, we avoid any cervical ripening or any atretinoid medication prior before starting the suction curettage. How we do the suction curettage? We start, we do under ultrasound guidance under GA, and then we scan, and then during the dilator by Higa, and then we try to evacuate by Kamen catheter under ultrasound guidance, and then started together with the pitocin induction. Right, so about 20 units mostly we use is about pitocin given, about 20 units during started of evacuation. Right, so okay, post-molar surveillance, about 50% or 15-16% complete mold may develop to GTN, right? Gestational topoblastic neoplasia, about 4-16% of partial mold can develop GTN, right? That's why we require to monitor serum beta HCG level, right? At least 1 to 2 weekly until undetectable. So after undetectable beta HCG, we may advisable. Undetectable means normalized beta HCG less than 5 international unit. Okay. So in terms of contraception, so actually after normalized beta HCG, we advise for contraception. The first line is a barrier contraception. So barrier contraception at least 2 weeks. And then it's safe to give COCP after that. Okay, but in terms of IUCD, there is risk of intractable pervaginal bleedings, and some authors say it's a risk of perforation, and some authors say it's a risk of in IUCD is expulsions. Okay. Okay. Alright, that's about the GTD. Okay. All about the